Mr. Wilson, it is my purpose in this interview to explore your views on the common market. However, I think one cannot ask about the common market referendum without, in a sense, also asking something about the economy. To ask whether, in the serious situation which it is generally admitted we are in, whether at a time when people fear that things are going to get worse rather than better, the whole common market referendum is not a diversion, and an unnecessary diversion at that.
I don't agree at all. Britain was taken into the common market by our predecessors after they had pledged they would not do so without the full-hearted consent of the British people, and that consent was manifestly neither forthcoming nor even sought. And there was great unhappiness about it. I do not think that people felt themselves at that time committed to the market. We felt the terms were grossly inadequate. Many vital interests had been given away. We said we would renegotiate, and at the end of that process we would ask the British people to decide. And what it means is this, that if the people, the sovereign people themselves, decide in favour of remaining in the market, then the whole nation is committed. And I believe you will find a much greater acceptance, even by those who have opposed entry into the market, a greater acceptance of our position and a much more wholehearted economic effort, management, salesmen, trade unions, than you could ever have had on the basis of a divided approach to entry.
Do you not feel, however, that some of the uncertainty that exists in Europe, in the banking places of the world, in the money places of the world, about Britain's future, is caused by the uncertainty waiting for the referendum?
No, I don't think that is really true. I think there are some people who expect Britain will vote, and we're not certain, who are waiting before they come to final decisions about trading with us, or, as you say, financial commitments one way and another. But I believe that the outcome will be, when we look back on all this, a month from now, will be a much more committed Britain if the people accept the advice of the government and vote to stay in.
Before moving away from the economy, may I put to you, Prime Minister, that there is a very difficult line for a Prime Minister in the current climate between exuding calmness and complacency. Do you worry at all that in fact you have exuded complacency rather than calmness?
I haven't. I don't worry about what people say about me. If I'd gone into a broadcast last week looking grim, they would have said that and said the situation must be much worse than he says. If I smile at all, then it's complacency. Look, I don't mind what people say. I know what the problems are, I know how we are tackling them with determination, and through two elections last year, I said that the economic problems we were facing were the gravest since 1931. They are, but I've also said, and it's not complacent, that for example on our trade figures, which are vital to the whole question of balance of payments and the pound, have immeasurably increased. In the last quarter of last year, excluding oil from it, oil had hardly happened, last quarter of 1973, excluding oil, we were about £900 million in the red on our balance of trade, visible and invisible. Now we're something like £1,500 million in the black on the last 3 months of this year. Now that's an achievement. I'd only like to see some people trumpet it to the markets of the world a bit more than they do. But I want to say this about the market, the common market. And that is that although I believe it will be very much harder to solve our economic problems outside in the situation in which we now are, we shall not solve our problems just by staying in the market. We shall not solve them certainly by pulling out. That will make them harder. We shall solve them by our own efforts, our own work, our own productivity, our own costs, and everything we do in exports. That's why, while the market argument is a very important one, it doesn't absolve us as British people from putting our own affairs right.
Could you spell out to the people, though, just how much harder our economic task would be if we pulled out of the market?
Yes. Now, remember, I have never been an emotional European. I don't stand on the south coast, look towards the continent and say, there's the New Jerusalem. I've never said that. I am, if I am emotional, I am an emotional Commonwealth man. It mattered a great deal to me when spontaneously the 33 heads of government of the Commonwealth said it matters to them that we stay in the market, and to some it matters very, very much indeed. You see, we criticised the terms. The Commonwealth were told to go and get lost and sell their New Zealand butter or cane sugar or whatever it might be somewhere else. And we paid a very heavy price, for example, in buying sugar at scarcity prices because of those terms. Nevertheless, they have found other markets. What we have done now is to reopen some of our markets to New Zealand, to the Commonwealth sugar producers and to others, and we've helped a great deal, and Europe has helped a great deal with some of the developing countries. But certainly, if we had to look for fresh markets now, it would be very difficult indeed, because so much has changed in the last 3 years.
Well, I mean, I remember Mr. Callaghan saying to me on another television programme of ours that it would be a traumatic experience if we were to come out of the market. Would it be a traumatic experience?
It would certainly be a traumatic experience, because a lot has happened in those 3 years. Many people I know who were against going into the market then say, well, we're in now, we've had 3 years there, the whole world market position has changed and other people are getting the goods we might have had. At the same time, Europe have made many changes to help Britain, especially during the renegotiations. And therefore, it would certainly be difficult to try and reconstitute our own trading patterns. For example, with EFTA. EFTA themselves, we were members of EFTA, of course, EFTA themselves have had to negotiate an agreement with the common market from outside. And they've been forced to accept all the restrictions on their freedom, their industrial and trading freedom that you have if you're a member of the market, but unlike those who are in the market, they can't make changes. We have made changes by being in.
Would it be fair then to say, Prime Minister, that you're not in fact an enthusiastic marketeer, but you are a pragmatic marketeer?
It's a practical approach. Yes, I think it is in Britain's interest and the Commonwealth's interest, and they said this for themselves, and I think the interest of the wider world. One thing that's happened in the 3 years, and particularly during the period of renegotiations, having in the market a troublesome country like Britain that likes to look outwards, you know, to across the Atlantic and to the wider world and to the Commonwealth, they're getting more outward looking as a result of our being there and our sort of banging the overseas drum a bit for them. I'm just not, as I say, I do not believe that membership of the common market solves all our problems by some magic wand. And while I welcome closer political relations with them, that is something which is happening all the time. And therefore, I have said all along, and my party said all along, we're neither in favour of being in Europe on principle or being out of the common market on principle. It depends on the terms and how the market itself develops. Now, I believe not only has the market changed very, very much, national interest now, we can urge and fight for national interests and get them more than would have been possible a few years ago. But remember, in the 3 years change of which I've spoken, the world has faced the cataclysmic effects of the oil crisis, the energy crisis, the commodities crisis, and therefore we're living in a totally different world from 3 years ago.
But you, Prime Minister, have got enough economic problems on your plate, as it were, without wishing any more that the no vote would bring. Why are you not out on the referendum hustings, really saying to the people, look, I need your yes vote, saying it as often and as many times as you possibly can?
You can certainly say, and I agree with you, you can say it again, that it would make our problems immeasurably more difficult if we got a no vote. James Callan and I are not going on any platforms of campaign groups. We are speaking to our own people. I believe we shall influence far more votes by that. I have already made a number of speeches quite early in the campaign. I've been abroad for a fortnight, of course, at the Commonwealth Conference, and I've got a very intensive program from now to the day of the vote in
different parts of the country. I do worry about... It does seem to me, I look at your speeches... There is this rather slight, we're recommending it, but nevertheless it's not quite that so important. Take it or leave it a bit, you know.
No, there's none of that. We are recommending it, and in strong terms. I have concluded that it is vitally in British interests, and as I say, the world interests and the Commonwealth interests, that the vote should be for Britain to remain. If I have qualified it, it's not in the way you have said, but what I've just said to you now, that this does not mean, stay in or pull out, that our economic problems will be solved by such a decision. Our economic problems have got to be solved by ourselves. But I do agree with what you put in your question, that it will be easier and more helpful to solve those problems if we are in the market, and if we're in beyond all doubt and the whole country is now accepting it, than if we were to be out of the market. That is something I feel very strongly indeed. You're quite right about that.
Is your decision to maintain something of a low profile in the debate born of your responsibilities as a Prime Minister or born of your responsibilities to maintain unity within the Labour Party?
Neither. It is because I believe our people are going to get a bit fed up with all the screaming and cacophony from both the campaigning sides to the point where they're just going to put the fingers in their ears to get a bit of peace.
Yes, I think they may be also getting confused.
No, well, the more they get confused by people claiming that this is an invention of the devil or it is an invention of the Almighty, the more they will listen, I think, to the calm voice of reason. That's how Jim Callan is approaching it, and I myself, we are both saying, look, we've been into this, give them our reasons. More people, I think, will listen to that approach than to the cacophony. But if you say I'm not being seen enough or heard enough, you better address that question to the broadcasting authorities. To think that in a 6-week campaign of vital importance to this country, I am given one program on independent television, one program on the BBC. That's not by my seeking, it's by some mysterious concept of balance which people with more ingenious minds than I have worked it out. So if they want me to speak to more people, they'd better wheel the cameras in again, hadn't they?
The question of balance is one I'd love to discuss with you at a future date, Prime Minister. At the moment, can we do some of the things that have been said?
But please don't criticise me that I'm not on television more.
Okay. Do you agree with Mr. Roy Jenkins, who described the debate as a conflict between extremists and moderates?
I think to some extent it's a conflict between committed people, people who wanted to be in the market even if they had to have the left foot cut off.
Extremists on both sides?
Yes, I think a lot of people made up their minds many years ago, I've said once, almost at birth or prenatal influences. And I think many of our people, more of our people are neither wholehearted Europeans or wholehearted anti-Europeans. Most of our people, I think, want to see what is in it for them. I don't mean in a vulgar material sense, what it means for the future of their children, what it means for Britain, what it means for the things we believe in abroad. I therefore don't regard it as extremists versus moderates. No, I would regard it, as I say, some people passionately committed to Europe at any price, some committed to pulling out even if we were given £1 million to every household in the country, others who take my view, let us judge what is best for ourselves, our children, and our country.
Do you dislike the kind of language used by Mr. Prentice the other day when he said, with one or two honourable exceptions, those opponents of the markets belong to the way out factions, the Tribune Group, a way out faction, the Communist Party, the Powellites, and the National Front? They are the fuddy duddies of politics.
You've got to realise that people are getting excited and sort of worked up about this. No, I do not agree with that language. I think it's a load of balderdash, frankly. But people do get worked up and express their views in a campaign. It's the same in election. People sometimes use somewhat immoderate language. I've always been a very moderate man in my language about my friends, about those I agree with and those I don't agree with sometimes.
Have you suggested they should cool it a bit?
No. What I have said is they mustn't get into sort of arguments with one another that will make it more difficult for us to pull together. Remember, on June the 6th, all the agreement to differ that I rightly, I think, accorded to them, that's over. They're pulling together as one team.
Do you really believe that can happen?
Yes, of course.
I mean, I wonder, you see, Mr. Thorpe seemed to me to be suggesting that some of the political alliances born of the market campaign might survive June the 6th. I don't know whether he was talking about himself, Mr. Heath and Mr. Jenkins all sitting together, but...
of course, the Liberal Party, you know, is really a coalition of about 12 different views. Is that how many members they've got? I can't remember. But they're always looking for coalitions and angles, poor things. But no, I do not agree with what he says. I believe that the fundamental questions facing Britain have got to be dealt with, and there are two broad ways of looking at it, the Tory view and the Labour view. And I think that on June the 6th we shall then know what the country decided, and then we've got to get down to tackling those problems.
Mrs. Shirley Williams, of course, said to me again on a programme that the if you had not given ministers the right to be seen publicly to disagree on the market during the campaign, the government would have broken up. Do you agree with that?
Not at all. The government wouldn't have broken up. But the reason I gave this right, and it is unprecedented, there was a sort of precedent in 1932. The reason I did it was that this is an issue that cuts right across every party. The Conservatives are much more divided than they have been much more divided than they have pretended, but they've got their own methods of twisting arms and all kinds of gentlemanly ways of making people see the light as their leaders see it. We're a more democratic party, but it cuts across, you know, it cuts across trade unions, it cuts across management, it cuts across even individual families. I know many families where, in the friendliest way, I mean, it doesn't mean that they throw the crockery at one another, where they do disagree fundamentally on this. That is bound to be so in any representative cabinet. My cabinet is representative of the whole party, I believe of the whole country, and I believe that it is right that on an issue of this kind, they should have freedom to express it in a comradely way, which in the main they're doing, God bless them. But at the end of the campaign, then it will be like, as a cabinet should be, everyone agrees on the majority view of the cabinet and accepts it, or if they don't agree, they know what they can do.
Can you help me with some of the facts that are, or so-called facts that are being bandied about? Mr. Eric Deakins, an undersecretary at the Department of Trade, said yesterday that most major foodstuffs are costing Britain more than if we were outside the EEC. Is that true?
Well, I'm really not going to get into an argument with my colleagues. They're all on the platforms, the hustings.
Oh, but that's a matter of fact,
I'm not going to argue with junior ministers. He's a very good minister, actually. But the food issue is a very important one and a difficult one. And it is a fact, I think I can say this as a fact, that certainly we have not had to pay more for food as a result of being in the market. I know other people will say that's because it's been a period of, they would say, temporary high prices. But I am satisfied that we certainly couldn't have got our food more cheaply anywhere else. The one thing I would say, and I want to be absolutely fair in this, is that because, as I said, our previous government in this country acquiesced in New Zealand being told to sell the goods elsewhere, then of course we couldn't count on that New Zealand food. Equally, breaking up the Commonwealth Sugar Agreement, which I introduced a quarter of a century ago, has meant at a time of shortage we had to buy high-priced sugar. But, you know, New Zealand wants the highest possible price for a butter and cheese. New Zealand's happy about the market. They want to relate their prices to the common market prices. No, I think the argument on food prices, apart from the, I think, stupid action about New Zealand and sugar 3 years ago, I think the argument is very finely balanced, but I certainly do not accept the view, whoever may state it, that in the last 3 years, now or in the future, it's going to mean dearer food for Britain than if we stayed outside. It certainly is not, in my view. There are nonsenses in the market, which we found when we got there, the butter mountain and selling off all the
butter to
the Soviet Union, the beef mountain. We are gradually getting sense, you know, we've greatly improved the agriculture and food policies so that these mountains should be disappearing, or where they exist, they're sold to our own people at low prices, not exported to ladies and gentlemen of the Soviet Union.
Okay, can I take up the point that's been made by another one of your ministers, that the EEC poses a positive threat to employment within the steel industry, but it also prevents us, perhaps prevents us doing some of the things we might want to do about other industries such as British Leyland. Does the EEC so
prevent? That is not true. No, I do not agree. On steel, I have nothing more really to add to what I said when I reported back from the last summit conference at Dublin. We are not satisfied with the position on steel, partly because, although, of course, any country in the common market can take businesses or industries into public ownership, there's no inhibition on that, no prohibition on that, there were one or two loopholes left in the provisions for steel, made worse, I think, by the conservative legislation after joining the market, which, for example, prevents us stopping a firm which is going to be established in South Wales in an area where we wouldn't have chosen, while men are being thrown out of work because of technological change in another part of Wales. And so I gave notice to the heads of government, and they took it, that we've got to find an answer to the steel problem. They've all done it. I mean, they just have their own methods by various incentives of getting the steel industry where they want it to be. We've said we'll study their methods. If we don't adopt them, then I shall have to seek if we can't adopt them, if there's any problem on steel, I have given notice we shall have to change the treaty. They understand this, and we shall get our own way on it. I'm quite satisfied.
But the EEC does not pose a direct threat to jobs in the steel industry.
That is my view. As I say, we shall have to get one or two changes agreed with them. I believe we shall get those changes made.
Now, Mr. Peter Shaw says that the being in the market will cost us £500 million a year or £2,500 million in a life of a parliament. Is that
well, a lot
correct?
Of estimates were made, indeed, by our own government in 1970, which have been proved wrong by the passage of events. A lot depends on how we run the market. You know, we're having a very big influence in the market. We've changed agriculture back to what we had in this country in 1947 and was thrown away in 1971. But if you take the first year, the estimates of our government in 1970, the estimates of the Conservatives about how much Britain would have to pay, you know, across the exchanges, net, for being in the market, those have been proved quite wrong. In fact, we've been taking money in over this past year, 1974-75, by being in the market. No one forecast that. And any forecast made must be very speculative, and I certainly do not accept that it's going to be ruinously expensive, partly because in the renegotiations we got a budget corrective mechanism agreed, which means that if we are paying more than our fair share, and I think the Tory negotiations would have led to that, we get it back.
Do you accept Mr. Foote's description of the institutions of the market as being totally undemocratic?
I told you that I am not going to use this programme for arguing with colleagues. You're just throwing up one thing after another. You haven't asked me about it. A few other people have been making remarks about it. I'm not going to get into an argument with them. I'll deal with the issues. Yes. That's what I'm supposed to be here for. It's my one programme. Give me a chance.
All right. Are the institutions of the market undemocratic?
They are not undemocratic. In the form, the treaty, the commission and so on, there are many bureaucratic procedures which other heads of government, as well as myself, want to change. No one has been more critical, for example, than the German federal chancellor, who says that the commission is bureaucratic and bloated and over expensive and all that. Well, I'm joining with him in the reform which has now been set in hand, for example, on agriculture. But what do we mean by democracy here? The real fact is that, and it's a big change from the treaty, it's a big change from 3 years ago. I've been surprised. Is that when you get nine heads of government, nine foreign ministers, sitting around a table, fighting for the national interests, and my heavens, the French and others are very good at that, as we are, then at the end of the day, what you agree is what is to the advantage of a lot of give and take of your own country. But in fact, you know, if they tried to force a decision on us affecting the economy, employment, steel, whatever you like, regional development, we wouldn't have it. They know we wouldn't have it. And the next night, when they came up for something they wanted, they'd be given a flat no, until we got what we wanted. This is normal international diplomatic thing. There's nothing undemocratic about it.
Prime Minister, we're almost at the end. The reason I've been putting these points to you in this way is that it seems to me that the great problem that people have about this is that they see ministers, members of the one cabinet, totally disagreeing about interpretation of about facts and about the interpretation of facts. And I think this confuses people. How on earth, if the ministers in your own cabinet cannot agree, can people be expected to make up their mind?
Well, I've explained that. As I say, these are things that people feel strongly about. It is a decision, not just for 3 years ahead, not even like a general election. It's not who's going to win the cup this year and somebody else next year. This is a decision for generations ahead. It's right that people should feel strongly. I'd be very ashamed of our party if they just took a tame acceptance of what I say.
How can people sort the truth from the chaff?
People will have to judge. The people are much more intelligent, you know, than you think. Much more intelligent. They've been much educated by, if I may say so, by television education programmes. I agree. But they've got to take decisions. Look, in a general election, they get two very strident voices about what's best for Britain. They've always been very good at deciding. Certainly very good four times out of the last five general elections we've had in this country. They'll sort it out, and they know that politicians get heated about this. And I don't apologise for the fact that some of my ministers take a bit different view from others, provided that we're all working like one cabinet, as we shall be in June.
Mr. Wilson, have you any contingency plans if the people say no?
We shall have to face it. I'm a Democrat. I'm not so arrogant and conceited as some people say they would be to say no to the decision of the British people. We'd have to face it. But I have made clear, and you gave me every opportunity earlier in the programme, that we would have a much harder economic row to hoe if the people did say no. It's going to be much more difficult. We believe that the worries we had about the market, the bad negotiating terms, are better. We believe they are now viable for Britain.
I think I asked you, have you any actual contingency plans?
Oh, sorry. The answer is we should have to introduce legislation to repeal the Treaty of Accession. That wouldn't be a very long job. The contingency plans wouldn't take long to work out. Certainly, I haven't been working on
them. What's the worst result that could happen? On a low poll with a tiny majority against?
Oh, I think the worst thing would happen is people get so bored with all the presentations and all the screaming and stridency and the press whipping themselves up on it, that people stay away from the polls. Yes, that would be the worst thing. The worst thing would be if nobody voted at all, but it's my determination to see they do, and to, as far as possible, that they vote what I consider to be the right way.
Mr. Wilson, you said the other day that you were at the helm. Do you know really where we're going in the last few seconds of this programme? Are you fully in command
of the ship? Into Europe, to stay in Europe, I hope. If you're talking about other things, yes, I think we know where we're going. In many things, we are very much improved compared with a year ago. You don't read that in the Tory newspapers. That is true. We're still a very long way to go.
Prime Minister, thank you very much indeed. Good night.